Hi everyone and welcome to our channel. Today's focus is on exocrine glands. We will begin with a brief comparison between endocrine and exocrine glands. A gland is an organ with an epithelium which produces and releases substances needed for a specific function of the body. We can divide glands into two major groups, the endocrine and the exocrine glands. Endocrine glands are mostly devoted to the regulation of homeostasis inside our organism. They are immersed in a highly vascularized capsule made of connective tissue. The capsule mediates the release of their products, called hormones, directly into the bloodstream. This system allows them to reach the target organs regardless of the distance that separates them from the gland. Exocrine glands instead mediate some chemical processes occurring on the internal and external surfaces of our body, as they are associated more or less tightly to the epithelia lining these areas. Due to this relationship, the transport of the secreted products is completely different as it occurs through a series of ducts. The rich variability of exocrine glands that are present in our organism leads to the necessity for a classification of these structures. First, we can divide them into unicellular and multicellular. Unicellular glands are also called goblet cells and are inserted in a lining epithelium with a free border either in hollow organs or on the skin surface. Their secretion is mainly composed of glycoproteins aimed to maintain the epithelium lubricated and hydrated. Multicellular glands have more complex tasks and diverse secretion products. Furthermore, the location of glands is a major tool of classification. We are talking about intra- and extramural glands. We describe a gland as intramural if it is located in the wall of the organ where it empties its content. Namely, parietal glands of the stomach fall into this category. We can furtherly divide intramural glands into intra- and extraepithelial, depending if they are inserted within the tunica mucosa layer of the organ or in the other tunica. We consider the lubricating glands of the trachea located in the tunica submucosa extraepithelial glands. Glands that extrude from the wall of the organ they serve are called extramural. The pancreas and the liver can be taken as examples. Moreover, based on the number of excretory units and branches of the duct, we divide glands into simple glands formed by a single secretory unit with one duct, for example, goblet cells, branched glands containing more secretory units that drain in one duct, some of the glands present in the stomach are structured in this way, and compound glands, having both a multiple number of subunits and a branch structure of ducts, for example, the salivary glands. The parenchyma of gland is organized in compartments through visible delimitations of connective tissue. Bigger units are called lobes, made of smaller subunits named lobules. Also, as mentioned before, the exocrine glands employ a system of ducts of increasing diameter, so we can observe the minimal unit, the secretion unit, composed by a small group of secreting cells drained by intercalating ducts. Intercalating ducts increase in diameter within the lobule and are called intralobular ducts. The secretion is then conveyed to an interlobular duct that releases its content in a large intralobar duct, responsible for the drainage of the biggest subunit we can observe in a gland, the lobe. From here, as the gland is constituted by two or more lobes, we have the gland's main duct, responsible for the complete collection and excretion of the product. A secretory unit consists of a group of epithelial cells which are arranged to secrete their products into a lumen connected to a duct. In the body, there are different types of secretory units. An acinar secretory unit has a spherical shape. Its products are fluid and have a proteic nature. In cross-section, the lumen appears narrow, with the single cells having a pyramidal morphology and rounded nucleus. A tubular secretory unit has a cylindrical shape, formed by columnar cells. It has an evident lumen in cross-section and generally produces a glycoproteic fluid. The cells have flattened nucleus located in their basal domain and are filled with mucinogen storage granules in the apical side of the cytoplasm. An alveolar gland has a wide and irregular lumen. A tubuloacinar secretory unit is an intermediate between acinar and tubular in terms of morphology and nature of secretion. Exocrine glands show three modalities of secretion. In merocrine secretion, the products are released by exocytosis. In apocrine secretion, bigger vesicles detach from the apical side of the cell with a sudden decrease in its dimensions. And in holocrine secretion, cells detach into the lumen of the secretory units along with their content. Finally, we can further specify the nature of the secretion valid for the merocrine glands only. Serous glands produce proteic watery secretions. In this case, the secretory units are acinar, intensely stained in hematoxin and eosin. Mucous glands have a viscous secretions made of glycoproteins in tubular units, which are not stained with hematoxin and eosin. Mixed glands have tubuloacinar secretory unit, with characteristic fragments of serous units, the Januzzi demilunes, contiguous to the mucous ones.